Tantar Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Checklist for Murder, The True Story of Robert John Peernock by Anthony Flacco, narrated by Anthony Flacco. Author's Note: The names of certain individuals who are not central to this story have been changed to preserve their privacy. A few small details that have no bearing upon the story's truth have also been altered, once again in the interests of protecting the privacy of those who have done nothing to warrant the dangers of public exposure. Concern for this level of privacy is based upon the fact that elements of lethal threat behind this story remain all too real at the time of this writing. Part 1. Monsters in the Dark. Torture, an extreme physical and mental assault on a person who has been rendered defenseless. Amnesty International. Chapter 1. She lay in the seat listening to the metallic sounds as he tinkered under the Cadillac. Was it safe to move? She still had a little physical control left despite her cuffed hands, her bound ankles, her blindness inside the canvas hood. But long hours in captivity, being force-fed a combination of alcohol and some kind of an unknown drug, had served to take a severe toll. Even though she was a healthy 18-year-old and had always been athletic, by this point it took all her effort just to make her slim body obey her. She reached out over her mother's unconscious form. Slowly she ran trembling fingers down the steering column until at last her fingertips brushed the ignition. The key was still there, but she pulled back. Could she start the car even though her hands were cuffed in front of her? Could she shift the transmission into reverse even though she couldn't see? Stomp on the gas even though her feet were tied? Most of all, could she do it fast enough to run the car over him before he heard her and scrambled out of the way? She had to try. There was no longer any doubt that he was about to kill them both. Once again, she leaned over her mother, stretching her cuffed hands out toward the key. But just as her fingertips finally reached the ignition, she realized the sounds under the car had stopped. Sometime before 4 a.m. on July 22, 1987, a motorist named John Dozier pulled over to the side of a desolate road. He peered into the early morning darkness and struggled to focus on a jumble of twisted wreckage off the right-hand shoulder. It seemed to be a single car wreck. No one was moving at the scene. He looked closer. A thin wisp of smoke was rising from the undercarriage of an old Cadillac resting near the side of the road. The rear of the car was still on the gravel shoulder, but the front straddled the remains of a wooden telephone pole. It appeared that the heavy 71 sedan had rammed the pole with such force that it had splintered and collapsed. The front of the car had come to rest on top of the remains of the pole as it lay on the ground. Dozier realized that the wreck must have happened only moments before, and that he was the first to come along. He knew on an isolated strip of road like this one, it might be hours before anyone else chanced by in the darkness. He hurried over, opened the driver's door of the Cadillac, and discovered a petite woman lying inside. She gave no signs of life. He tried to pull her free, but she was jammed under the dashboard beneath the steering wheel. On the floor beside her, he could hear a female passenger moaning softly. But the door on the passenger side was jammed in place, and there was nothing he could do to free the second victim either. Then he remembered the thin wisp of smoke rising from under the car. He realized an explosion could happen at any second. Dozier hurried away to find a phone and call for help. At 4:25 on that same July morning, paramedic Clyde Pipehoff was sleeping through the quiet hours of a 24-hour shift at Fire Station 89 in the North Hollywood area of Los Angeles when he received a radio dispatch over his hotline. The call came from the main dispatch center in downtown L.A., located 5 riot-proof floors below ground level. The order directed him to proceed to San Fernando Road near the Tuxford intersection in the neighboring town of Sun Valley. Clyde was a supervisor with the rank of paramedic 3, serving all county municipalities, so the call was within his jurisdiction. He summoned his partner, paramedic 2, Todd Carb, and their trainee, Paul Aghizzi. Within moments, they were rolling toward the scene. Clyde's problems began immediately. There are 2 San Fernando roads that intersect Tuxford. He made his best guess and arrived shortly afterward at what he considered the more commonly traveled of the 2 locations. The new strip of road where most of the traffic could be expected to go. There was nothing there. Knowing he was losing precious seconds, he and his crew rushed toward Old San Fernando Road, a lesser-used strip of dead-end road running slightly north of a set of railroad tracks. There they finally spotted the dispatch incident. 4 minutes had elapsed since their call came in. Clyde saw the first body before he and the crew had even exited their ambulance. The woman lay on the floor under the steering wheel, her back against the driver's seat and her head slumped against the door frame. Her knees were jammed up under the dashboard with her right arm on the floor and her left arm trailing out of the open driver's side door and onto the ground. He did not notice the missing section of the underside of the dash or the exposed brackets for mounting stereo equipment because, in his mind, the woman became Clyde's patient the moment he arrived on the scene. Visibility inside the car was a problem. The dome light was not on, even though the driver's side door was open. His attention was already fixed on assessing her condition, but he suspected that once he reached the woman, his check for vital signs would be useless. In addition to clear evidence of massive blood loss, Clyde's patient had sizable portions of brain matter exposed just above her eyes. After his first quick check of the woman hanging out of the doorway, Clyde saw a second body on the floor of the passenger side. The second passenger, also a female, wasn't moving either. He called for Todd and Paul to circle around the car to look after the second passenger while he knelt by the driver's side passenger to continue his preliminary assessments. The smell of gas is typical in bad car wrecks, but Clyde noticed that the odor from this wreck was unusually strong. Glancing around the interior of the car, he saw puddles of fluid on the floorboards. Alarmed that they could be dealing with an active fuel leak, Clyde quickened his pace. In that first brief moment, he had also noticed that blood was also splattered across the inside of the windshield and over the gear shift area. But there was, oddly, no damage at all to the windshield itself or the steering column. In fact, with the exception of all that blood, the interior of the car did not appear damaged at all. At that moment, he couldn't tell if the splattered blood was from one or both of the women, but when Clyde spotted a thin leather strap, several feet long and knotted at both ends, lying across his patient's face, he immediately began conducting his movements so as to disturb things as little as possible. He had been trained to do it that way whenever something about a simple wreck indicated that it might be a crime scene. Meanwhile, Todd and Paul were having trouble getting the passenger's door pried open. The point of impact was on the right front of the car, but the shock had distorted metal all along the car's right side. Quickly retrieving a manual retractor called a Hayward from their unit, they began working to free the second patient. While Clyde was occupied with his examination of the woman on the driver's side, other details of the scene continued to strike him as strangely out of place. A partially empty bottle of whiskey lay in the driver's footwell, but the odor inside the car was more like gas than alcohol. The driver's clothing was soaked, but there again the odor on the clothing was that of gasoline and not alcohol. Most of all, the driver's head injuries were so severe, her face so bloodied and distorted that he couldn't even guess her age. Clyde couldn't imagine what she might have collided with inside the car that would tear her up so badly without also showing some sign of damage to the impacted object itself. The urgency of the situation, with the car's interior puddled with gasoline, kept him from continuing his trauma evaluation. With nothing else to go on but his initial impressions, he noted that the driver was small and trim, with no visible signs of aging. He estimated her age to be around 30, while he quickly checked her vital signs. At 4:35 a.m., Clyde pronounced his patient dead at the scene. On the passenger side, Todd and Paul called out to Clyde that the second victim showed faint signs of life. As soon as they began to check her, leaning in the window to determine her condition, they confirmed what Clyde had already noticed. There was a strong odor of gas inside the car. It was pooled on the floor around the second victim, soaking through her clothes. John Dozier had returned to the scene and stood off in the background watching the action. And at that moment he called out a warning to the driver of a street sweeper from a nearby gravel company who had pulled his rig over to protect the scene from traffic. Dozier directed the driver's attention to the source of smoke under the car. When Clyde hurried around to assist his partners in removing the survivor, the street sweeper's driver relayed the warning of fire danger to Clyde. Clyde dropped to his knees and peered under the car. A piece of rope that he would later describe as looking like a wick hung from the undercarriage below the gas tank area. The rope had been partially burned. The end of the rope still smoldered. The smoldering rope made it imperative to immediately get the surviving young woman out and away from the car. It was also vital to get an engine company on the scene for fire-related backup. The deceased driver would have to remain in the car. Clyde ran to his unit and put out the call for additional aid, then rushed back to help Todd and Paul remove the survivor. Given the severity of her injuries, they moved her out as quickly as they could. But like the woman on the driver's side, the passenger had suffered massive trauma about her head and face. It took extra precious seconds to handle her with extreme care as they got her strapped to a backboard with her arms and legs fixed in place and a cervical collar stabilizing her neck. Such precautions are standard under the circumstances, but careful handling of the surviving female became more urgent when they found what appeared to be brain matter on her clothing. The paramedics didn't know yet if the brain matter was hers. They rushed the surviving passenger away on the gurney to begin first aid at a spot behind their ambulance, which had been parked away from any possible flow of gasoline from the wrecked car. They knew it would be a fight to stabilize her enough for the ride to nearby Holy Cross Hospital. With an apparently severe skull fracture and the resulting possibility of coma, the traumatic shock of moving could kill her. The surviving female groaned softly and muttered a few delirious words. Head injury patients tend to go in and out of consciousness, so whenever a victim seems alert enough to speak, paramedics will take the opportunity to attempt a few basic questions to determine if the patient is oriented. Clyde asked her name but got no intelligible answer. All three paramedics were struck by the fact that even away from the accident scene, the young woman's clothing still reeked of gasoline. While Clyde directed the treatment and the gentle questions, he noticed an engine company arriving in response to his call. Firefighters used a 2.5-gallon water gun to soak down the smoldering rope under the car. Then they pulled a hip line over to spray off the accumulated gas under the car, reducing the danger of explosion. Amid the flash of emergency lights, the typical noise of an accident scene was beginning to drone in the pre-dawn darkness. Idling engines rumbled under the crackles of dispatch radios. Todd and Paul continued with the surviving passenger while Clyde asked the firefighters to leave the deceased woman in place after the fire danger was controlled. He knew that police investigators would not want anything disturbed more than necessary. Meanwhile, Todd and Paul were unable to orient the survivor. She couldn't identify herself, tell what had happened to her, or even say if she knew where she was. Her breath smelled slightly of alcohol, but it seemed unlikely that alcohol could be the cause of her incoherent condition. Natasha Peernock was in the place dreams come from, dreams or nightmares. Her eyes could register forms moving, her ears could register sounds, but her conscious mind had been knocked aside and the messages coming in through her senses were getting lost somewhere deep within her. They mingled with the rest of her unconscious, with memories, with hallucinations. Whatever was taking place in the three-dimensional world around her, or even in that tiny part of the world right outside her own skin and bones, it would all have to go by without her help, without her attention, without her even taking notice. Arson investigators Michael Camello and Derek Chu responded to the 8600 block of Old San Fernando Road between 5 and 5:30 that morning. They saw a fire engine, a patrol car, and a paramedic ambulance already there, plus a handful of onlookers. The hood and trunk of the car were open. Fire Captain Gene Allen told them that when he had arrived on the scene, he'd found both lids closed, but that his men had had to open the hood to check for possible sparking. The firefighters had also taken the trunk key from the ignition in order to open the trunk and make the same check there. Camillo and Chu had been summoned to determine if this was a crime scene. Had someone intended this car and the people inside of it to explode in flames? In those first moments, they learned that a surviving passenger had already been removed from the car and was being given preliminary treatment in the ambulance, but that she was in no condition to offer them any information. The heavy car was built like a battle tank. Despite a collision severe enough to tear down a telephone pole, most of the damage to the car was in the area of the right front fender. Other than having one front wheel collapsed, the car was, incredibly, almost drivable. Inside the passenger compartment, Camello and Chu shared the reactions of the others, amazed that there was no observable damage to the interior, other than a minor ding in an air conditioning vent and a thin crack in the lower right portion of the windshield. Even that small fracture was a single stress crack, not the sort of spidery impact lines that distinguish a blow to the glass from the inside. They observed the deceased woman still in her original position on the driver's floor of the car. Camello spotted a single brown work glove on the floor next to the body and a capped bottle of Seagram's 7. In his experience, it seemed odd for anyone to drive with a large bottle of such hard stuff, but he also knew that people are completely unpredictable in their drinking habits. Camello and Chu noted a large amount of blood on the dash and on the floor. Camello suspected that some of the residue was brain matter. Like the paramedics, he and Chu agreed that the deceased woman was in terrible shape for being in such a well-preserved automobile. Camello looked inside the open trunk. He saw a gas can, scraps of paper, rags, and a wooden stick. It appeared that they had all been burned recently. The rags still felt warm to his touch. He directed photos to be taken while he checked to see if there were any exposed wires that might have ignited the trunk contents in some accidental way. But although he knew that anything is possible with explosive liquids, the trunk fire had already struck arson investigator Camello as being incendiary in nature. The site under the vehicle was also consistent with a crime scene. He noted that the rope wick near the gas tank was wrapped around some type of metal bar. The bar had a sharpened edge and was pointed toward the gas tank with the tip of the point about half an inch from the fuel supply. The other end of the bar was secured to the car's undercarriage by a single screw. Even though everything under the car was dirty, the single screw holding the pointed bar was shiny and clean. Camello noted some darkening on the underside of the gas tank, appearing to be a hydrocarbon burn residue. The location of the partially burned rope added to Camello's suspicions of attempted arson. But with a dead woman in the front seat and a delirious female pulled from the wreckage, the scene left no doubt in his mind that it revealed arson for the purpose of murder. Somebody had gone to a great deal of trouble to turn this car into an elaborate, self-destructing death machine. Camello then began searching for the source of the gasoline leak. Despite the strong, persistent odor, he could find no ruptures in the tank itself. He untied the end of the rope from the pointed metal bar and pulled the bar's pointed end down, away from the fuel tank. Once the pointed bar no longer blocked his view of the tank, Camello noted that there was a tiny area of the tank's surface that had been scraped clean. It looked as if the point had momentarily brushed the metal, such as it might do in a collision of insufficient force to actually cause a rupture. Thus, it was possible to speculate that if the big Cadillac had not been stopped by the telephone pole, and if the car's huge V8 engine had gone on building momentum until the car hit the retaining wall at the road's dead end, the metal bar could have rammed and punctured the gas tank. With the rope wick still burning and attached to the metal bar secured under the fuel tank, there could have been an explosive, extremely hot fire. With the amount of gasoline pooled inside the heavy car's interior, Camello knew that the county coroner would have been lucky to be able to identify the car's two passengers through dental records. Paramedic 3, Clyde Pipehoff, climbed in the back of the ambulance to prepare to load the patient with Paul, the trainee. Todd got in front to drive them to the hospital. After repeatedly asking the patient if she could tell him the name of the other woman in the car, Clyde finally got a momentary response from the young woman. She was able to murmur the name Patty, but did not give a last name. Clyde went back to check the car for IDs and found two purses, one with a driver's license in the name of Claire Peernock. He assumed the other purse must belong to Patty, whom his patient had identified as the deceased woman. If the disoriented woman in his ambulance was Claire Peernock, she certainly didn't look like she was over 40 years old, as the California driver's license indicated. In fact, neither of the two women looked that old, but their faces were so bloodied and distorted by the trauma that anything was possible. There was no time to sort it out. One of the paramedics tossed Claire Peernock's purse into the ambulance while they all got ready to roll. As the first pale light of pre-dawn began to show, supervising paramedic Clyde Pipehoff greeted the day knowing he had just received a hardcore illustration of the need to be prepared to deal with anything, at any time, on his 24-hour shift. Do you know your name? Do you know where you are? Do you have any idea what happened to you? The gentle questions of the paramedics drifted in Natasha's ears. They stirred reflexes in her brain, even elicited a few partial responses. But those responses, the words and the pieces of words, didn't come from Natasha as anyone knew her. They didn't even come from Natasha as she knew herself. They were spatters from her unconscious thought stream, bubbling up through her vocal cords like sprays of some nonsense conversation held with a sleepwalker. Because Natasha was hovering in a place where things she had done long ago were occurring over and over on a never-ending loop, while things she had only planned to do in the future seemed to have already taken place. Any response that people in the so-called real world would get from her now would only come from far down inside of that place, where dreams and memories and plans and fears all jumble up like brightly colored bits of glass shaken together in a box. The paramedics did everything they could to get her to fight her way back to a semblance of consciousness, but Natasha was wandering the darkness, down where the nightmare factory likes to crank up its assembly line deep in the night, where familiar shapes can turn into monsters and strike out at you, then snap back into harmless images all in the blink of an eye. She was alone in the innermost chamber of some dark cave where the paramedics, the police, the doctors could not go. They couldn't even summon her back. If Natasha returned at all, she was going to have to come back on her own. Chapter 2. It was after midnight on July 23rd, more than 20 hours after the crash was discovered, when Natasha's consciousness slowly returned. She fought to open her swollen eyelids, but the torn, puffed flesh around her eyes barely let in any light. Overhead lights were on. There was nothing around her to indicate time. Her contact lenses had been removed, leaving a haze she could only see through well enough to realize she was lying in a hospital bed. She got the impression that she was the only patient in the room, but had no idea yet that the severity of her wounds and the intensity of her treatment had dictated a private recovery environment. In fact, she had awakened earlier just long enough to be approved for transfer from the ICU to a private room, but she had no memory of that. Moments later, while she fought back the groggy remnants of anesthesia, she became aware of a nurse puttering about her bedside, adjusting IV drips, monitoring her vital signs. When the nurse saw Natasha's eyes flutter open, she smiled down at her with a detached, professional gaze. "Do you know where you are?" the nurse asked softly. Natasha had to struggle to make her lips form a word, to make her throat push out a sound. "A hospital," her voice rasped out in a dry whisper. "That's right," the RN said, never dropping her trained smile. "How does your head feel? Do you think you could answer a few questions?"
What happened?
She pushed the whisper a little harder, but her vocal cords weren't ready to come back online.
"Well, it seems that you were in some kind of an accident, a car accident, so can you tell me your name?"
"Natasha." She quit pushing her voice and let the whisper do the work. Her mouth was too dry, her tongue felt thick and heavy. "And your last name?"
"Peernock."
The moment she pronounced her family name, Natasha felt a small shockwave go through her. She wasn't sure why.
"Good. And what year is it, Natasha?"
Natasha's first name sounded odd coming from this woman. People who know her usually just call her Tasha, sometimes shortening it simply to Tosh. To hear the formality of her full name as she lay helpless only emphasized to her that she was in a strange place. But a moment later she realized that she couldn't answer the question. She didn't know what year it was. At first it felt kind of funny to find a piece of her memory gone. It wasn't like anything she had ever heard about amnesia. After all, she knew who she was. And when the RN told her that this was Holy Cross Hospital, she recognized the name. She had driven by the place in the past. But her memory had been Swiss cheesed, and little pieces were simply missing. She got her street address right, but she couldn't remember the name of the current U.S. president. She could picture his face, but the name was blank. And now another shockwave jolted her. This one was stronger. It shot through her like an icy wind, and suddenly she didn't feel like answering any more riddles. Her right hand rose absently to her forehead and sent strange messages to her brain. Her hair was gone. There were sutured gouges all across her face and head. But the messages were too much to deal with at the moment.
My Mother was with me. As Tasha spoke the word mother, it caught in her throat. She didn't know why. She knew, but she couldn't focus on the thought. Where's my mother? She kept her voice quiet, almost timid. The nurse was well-trained, and her smile hardly wavered. You can see your mother later, she started for the door. Rest now. You've just come out of surgery. We were concerned about you there for a while. I'm sure your mother would want you to rest. My mother, she began again, but the nurse was making good her escape. She was nearly all the way out the door as she turned back to offer one last polished smile. We'll be coming in and out to check on you, she chirped as she disappeared. But those last words and their artificial assurance didn't matter anyway. Natasha barely heard them. Distant images, sounds, and voices suddenly overwhelmed her. A revolver's chamber spinning next to her ear over and over and over, crashing sounds of a violent struggle coming from the other side of a bedroom wall, the cold feel of steel handcuffs, the suffocating panic as thin strips tightened around her throat, ropes being pulled tight around her ankles, a voice assuring her that she was going to be killed. The second registered nurse to check on Natasha that evening was just making a routine stop. She didn't know much about the patient. She knew the young woman was a severe head trauma victim of an auto accident earlier that morning. She knew that an ER test had indicated that there was a 0.053 blood alcohol level hours after the accident. The odor of alcohol had still been on her breath. Traces of some form of narcotic had also been in her bloodstream, most likely another drunken car wreck. The nurse also knew the hospital had been notified that shortly before 11:30 that evening, a neighbor named Carl Rowe had come down to the coroner's office and positively identified the fatality as being this patient's mother. But the RN wasn't about to be the one to get stuck with breaking the news. So she walked into the room determined to do no more than make sure the patient was awake and remaining alert. The nurse would check the IV drip rate, the vitals, assured that the patient's orientation was returning, she would leave the emotional confrontations to somebody else. But the moment the RN stepped inside, the patient turned to her and began to display great anxiety. It's common for head trauma patients to register inappropriate levels of emotion as a side effect of their injuries, so the nurse began her routine and answered the questions with matter-of-fact professionalism. "Where's my mother?" the young woman moaned. "Where you can see her later," the nurse replied in her prescribed line that had been carefully crafted to tell the truth, even while concealing it. "My father, then, where is he?" The young woman's voice was still thick from anesthesia, from the trauma. Clearly she was forcing herself to speak, showing great concern. Still, the symptoms were common enough, not at all unusual for a head trauma victim. "I don't think your father was involved. No one said anything to me about a male victim being at the scene. Don't worry. Try to get some rest. You took a real..."
"No! My father! The police! My father!"
The nurse had finished her brief check. There were a lot of other patients left to go. The workload left no time for chat. "Try to rest. You were in a serious accident." The RN remained in the doorway for a moment longer than her schedule permitted. The patient was so distraught that the nurse paused to offer more reassurances, telling her not to worry about her father for the time being, reciting the line about how she could see her mother later. There wasn't much else she could do to ease the patient's agitated state. Strong tranquilizers can't be given to head injury patients so soon after surgery, and the nurse couldn't stay any longer to offer personal comfort. So she just made a mental note to add a few extra stops to this room on top of the usual schedule of every 15 minutes that the patients in critical recovery normally get at Holy Cross. And then she was gone. In the back of her mind, she was already reviewing the history on the next patient. Even though Natasha lay helpless, unable to take any physical action, old mental skills that she had honed with years of practice went to work automatically. She struggled to focus her mind, to force herself to remember everything and glue it all into place. She ran through the memories as if through a piece of film, staring hard at the mental images just as she had learned to do years ago, back when some inner wisdom had told her that the very first resource of those who refuse to be willing victims is to remember. Remember everything. Remember with a vengeance. part of her wondered fearfully where her father was at that very moment. Was he nearby, trying to get into the hospital? Would she even know him if he appeared in the room? Without her contact lenses, she couldn't see as far as the doorframe. Shapes were blurred so badly at that distance she wouldn't even know if the person coming in was wearing a hospital uniform. Natasha had no idea how much longer she might survive, but enough of her memory had returned so that she knew without a doubt that there was somebody out there with a very strong motivation to kill her before she could remember all of the details, and before she could get someone to listen to her. So as each minute dragged by, she labored to retrieve every scrap of memory and set it in proper order among the others, to remember. It had been just after 5 o'clock on the afternoon on which the crimes began, when her best friend, Patty, pulled the white Ford Festiva to a stop in front of Natasha's house and parked with the engine idling. The July sun was still high over the horizon. It wouldn't be dark for over 3 hours. "Sure you don't want me to come in, Tasha? Your dad's car is here." "No," Tasha replied, getting out and closing the door. She leaned back into the open window. "I was supposed to do some laundry before we went to stay at Jennifer's last night, and I have to mow the lawn before we go back out. Besides," Natasha teased her with a grin, "these are the same clothes we had on yesterday. You're not going to Magic Mountain in that outfit, are you?" They had been friends for a long time. It was never hard for Tasha to get a rise out of Patty, and Tasha knew just how far she could get away with pushing her. "Hey, I don't have to go change right this second," Patty scowled, annoyed, but she glanced at Robert Peernock's car and made no move to turn off the engine. "Go on," Natasha smiled wanly. "I'll call in a couple of hours. My Fiat's still dead, so if Mom won't let me use her car when she gets home from work, you can come back." She noticed that Patty didn't look pleased. "Hey, okay?" Patty sighed and met Tasha's eyes with a resigned smile. "Yeah, okay. But I'm sure your mom will just fork over her keys after the way you trashed her car before. Look, it's not like I'm afraid to come in if you want me to." "I know, I know. I'll call you." Natasha pushed away from the window. "Remember to call Eric and Jeff and make sure they're still going to meet us." She waved, and Patty nodded, then drove off. The front door was locked. This caught her by surprise. She had to pause for a few moments and fish around for her key. The house was usually unlocked when anybody was home, and right now both of her father's cars were in the driveway. He hadn't lived with the family for the last 4 years, spending nearly all his time at his girlfriend's condominium 30 miles away. But although Tasha had been hoping to get her chores done before her mother came home from work, it was clear that she wasn't going to be alone there today. Her father was somewhere inside the house. She got the door open, stepped in, closed it behind her. It had been a long time since she had come home to find him there. For years now, if some errand required him to be at the house, he had always made it a point to be gone before her mother got home. That policy suited Natasha fine. She didn't need to listen to the fighting. Now she paused on the tile section inside the doorway and listened for just a moment. The house was totally quiet. It seemed empty. Tasha hoped she was going to be in luck. She didn't realize she'd been holding her breath until she heard herself sigh heavily as Robert Peernock appeared from the backyard and opened the sliding glass door to come inside. She had a straight view to the back of the house while he stepped in. Their eyes met through the glass. If she stayed in his line of vision, they would have to talk. But if she didn't talk, he might take it as an insult. So she broke off the gaze and headed down the hallway to her bedroom just as he stepped inside and shut the sliding door behind him. Tasha tried not to hurry. She knew that if she rushed, it might provoke him. The words would pepper her like bullets. "What are you running from? What did you do this time?" So she hurried, the way she had learned to do, keeping her moves casual but quick. The escape was good. A few seconds later, she was in her room, hoping for the sound of the front door closing and for his car to start up in the driveway. She wondered, why was he here so late anyway? For the past month or so, he had been coming around much more than usual, nearly every day, picking up personal items, paper files, clothing, tools, and whenever she happened to come in while he was there, he never failed to berate her about something. Her friends, her schooling, her style of dressing, the cost of utilities in the house, name it. The same old yelling story, she called it. There was no use fighting it. Instead, she became skilled at avoidance. Tasha puttered around the room, killing time. She changed into more casual shoes to mow the lawn in, and decided not to put on fresh clothing until her chores were done, and still there was no sound of him leaving. Finally, she ran out of ways to kill time and gave up in exasperation. She couldn't hang up the rest of the day by hiding, so she decided to just go on out, carry out her business as quietly as she could, work on her invisibility. She didn't see him when she walked back down the hallway and went into the kitchen, so she relaxed a little and began making herself something to eat. It was just a snack before going out. Her plans for the evening didn't include having dinner at home. She hadn't started eating yet when Robert walked into the kitchen from the family room. At first, everything seemed normal enough. He leaned against the door frame and watched her for a moment. Then he casually asked if she had any plans for the evening. But she wasn't about to open that can of worms if she didn't have to. She told him she wasn't sure. He asked if Patty was coming over. Robert knew they were inseparable. Patty had lived there for several weeks recently while she was having trouble at home. She stayed until it got worse there than it was at her place, and her own home didn't look so bad anymore. But Robert hadn't taken a liking to her, and Tasha knew he wouldn't be thrilled to hear they were planning on staying out late with friends tonight, so she played dumb on that one, too. Tasha tried to focus on making her simple meal, trying to get the message across to him that there wasn't any point in talking to her, but doing it gently enough to avoid setting him off. It didn't do any good. He just kept hanging in the doorway. His questions turned to the topic of her mother. Was she due home today? Was she working late? Did she have plans tonight? Tasha played dumb to all of it. But maybe she ignored her father a little too hard this time. Perhaps that's why the irritation in his voice changed so abruptly to raw anger. He suddenly dropped his questions, began pacing back and forth in the doorway, berating her for the high utility costs as he waved an electricity bill at her. He reminded her that even though he didn't live there, he still paid a lot of the bills, and that as long as she stayed in his home and she was on orders to turn off the television every time she left the room. Throughout the tirade, she glanced at him often enough to avoid making him feel like he was being ignored. She had learned how to do it so that she hardly even saw him. Her concentration kept focused on getting the food ready, moving very evenly, deliberately. An invisible blanket softened the blows of his verbal attack. Finally, he played himself out and walked away from her in disgust. He returned to the backyard patio, sliding the glass door closed behind him as he went. But he left the TV on in the family room. Tasha shook her head with a grim smile, so much for his concern about energy. She began to hurry, trying to get the food ready while he was still outside. Maybe the chores could wait until tomorrow if he wasn't going to leave her in peace. The food was almost ready. In a few minutes, she could get it down and be gone. She could always walk to Patty's place. It wasn't that far. She could shower there if she had to, even borrow some clothes if there wasn't time to change before Robert came back inside. But she was hungry, so she didn't walk out right away. She didn't want to give up on the idea of finishing her meal before she left. She was just beginning to eat when Robert came back inside. At the same time, the sound of the sliding glass door somehow brought the blaring television in the next room back to her attention. It was galling to be yelled at so stupidly over some miserly energy policy that he didn't even follow himself. The urge to fight back rose quickly inside her. She had just graduated from high school and felt the power of her independence, her beauty, her strong spirit. She might have kept her mouth shut if she had taken a moment to think about it, but the words leapt out into the air, fueled by years of resentment and this new feeling of strength that was just beginning to enter her life. "What was that you said about the TV?" she called to him as he passed the kitchen door. "What?" he stopped, turned back, stood glaring in the doorway. "What did you say?" But she knew he had heard her. His voice tone gave it away, his expression. Still, the need to recapture something of her assaulted dignity was strong inside her. "The television," she continued. "I didn't turn it on. So who did?" His eyes turned to steel. The corners of his mouth turned up slightly, but it wasn't a smile. It was smug, dangerous. Without words, the expression said, "You've played into my hands." Tasha wasn't really seeing him, even though her eyes looked directly at him. She felt offended down into the marrow of her bones by this father stranger whom she saw as only coming over in the last 4 years when he felt like making trouble, grumbling around the place like some guy just waiting for anybody to knock the chip off of his shoulder. She was sick of the years spent standing silent under the onslaught of his same old yelling story. She had raised the invisible blanket again. And so she just had to add one more line. Because you would never turn the TV on and then walk out of the room for half a minute, would you? Who's wasting the electricity now? She knew he would hit the ceiling at that one. She expected him to scream and yell and threaten her. She even knew that there was a good chance he would strike her, maybe knock her to the floor, as he had in the past. So she wasn't really all that surprised when, without a word, he leapt the distance between them and grabbed her with both hands around her throat. As he clamped her windpipe closed, her hands went instinctively to his wrists and held on tight. He didn't say a word as he pounced on her, and she couldn't do anything more than gasp for what little air still managed to bleed in through her constricted throat. Tasha's adrenaline spurted through her. It made their movements seem to snap into slow motion, as if the duo had lapsed into a deadly graveyard waltz. He drove her with his weight, forcing her to back up as he spun her around in the opposite direction and slowly walked her out of the kitchen. Robert was 6 feet tall and weighed over 180. She struggled, but it was useless. At 5 feet 8 inches and 130 pounds, even though Tasha's slim frame was built on long legs and firm muscles toned from her love of outdoors and physical activities, even though Tasha had grown up a tomboy and was never seriously accused of being a wimp by anybody, she had neither the physical nor psychological strength to mount any real defense against a sudden and brutal attack from her father. He directed all the power of his rage into clamping her throat closed while he drove her steadily into the next room. Now, for the very first time since he had given her swimming lessons so many years ago, for the first time since Tasha was a doting toddler, obedient to Daddy's every word, for the first time since those days years before, when Robert was still the flattered father who loved his beautiful young daughter, the two moved once again in perfect sync. They became a father-daughter dance team as they staggered onward together. Tasha's feet were barely on the ground as she struggled, twisted, writhed in his grip, dancing on air. Moments later, they ended their last waltz as she fell backward, and Robert landed atop her on the floor of the family room. But even with Tasha flat on the floor and helpless in his grip, his hands kept biting into the soft flesh of her neck. Up to that moment, Tasha hadn't felt that afraid, not really. She became calm. If normal and natural fear was blasting through her insides at the realization that she was under deadly attack, years of conditioning had calloused the part of her where she ought to have felt it. Her instinct for self-preservation took over, and prior family experience rushed in to go to work. She had weathered a lot of his violent storms in the past, and had usually come through them without having to go to the hospital. She knew the trick. Don't resist. Take whatever blows he has to deliver and let his rage burn off before you get seriously hurt. Ever since she had foolishly stepped between Robert and Clara during that big family fight back when she was 13, ending up with a shattered arm and 3 weeks of traction for her foolishness, Tasha had learned well the lesson of dealing with her father's rage. Let him lead. He feeds on open defiance. Keep him as quiet as you can and wait for your chance to escape. But now the impact of the floor against her back and the weight of his body on top of hers brought Tasha's true emotions home. She instantly filled with a high-octane mixture of fear and outrage that struggled to explode out of her. She felt the cries building inside, hammering to get out. But the only point of self-control left to her was the need to avoid giving him the slightest satisfaction at terrorizing her. She strangled her own sobs down in her throat even harder than Robert was strangling her with the pressure of his thumbs. Keeping her eyes hard, she held the cries deep inside until, without warning, Robert stopped the attack. It ended as suddenly as it had begun. He remained on top of her, panting slightly, staring down into her face. Tasha began to hope that it was finally over, that she had played him correctly and let him satisfy his rage and his need to assert domination before she had to endure a more serious form of violence. "Are you okay?" he asked matter-of-factly, as if she had just fallen off a bicycle. Tasha glared up at him as he pulled his hands from her throat. All her fear had already given way to indignant outrage. "I'll live," she answered as harshly as she could, voice still husky from the shock to her vocal cords. She rubbed her throat and avoided looking into his eyes. She wasn't afraid to meet his gaze, but didn't want to absorb any more of his energy than she had to. Enraged thoughts flashed through her at lightning speed. This was it, she thought to herself. She was out of this dump permanently. After all, she'd only remained living in her mother's house because Robert had been separated from Claire for the last few years, supposedly giving Tasha a chance to grow up in some amount of peace. But if he was going to start showing up around the place again, acting this way whenever he wanted to, she was absolutely getting out. Now that she was 18, nobody could force her to stay there anymore. Meanwhile, Robert kept staring down at her and regarding her curiously, as if wondering exactly what his next move should be. When he finally spoke, all trace of his rage was gone. "You have to understand, Natasha, I just can't go on like this anymore." He spoke softly, making an appeal for her to respect his deep need to strangle her. He shook his head sadly, full of pain. "Not the way my life is." He sat back, still straddling her, but he didn't get up. He just shook his head again, deeply depressed about the way his life felt to him. Natasha inhaled hard, pulling enough air into her chest to manage a reply. She forced the words out of her throbbing throat. "Well, you don't have to worry about it anymore. I'm moving out. Patty and I are getting our own place. I was going to tell Mom anyway. I'm never coming back here. I won't be a part of your life anymore." Maybe her reply caught him off guard. His response threw her a curve. "Do you need any money?" He remained on top of her, holding her flat on her back with his weight. She glared up at him. So, she thought with disgust, now he was offering her a bribe. "I don't want any money from you." She was used to his abrupt changes of tone, but from now on all of that would only exist in the past. Natasha knew in her heart that she would never willingly remain in this house now. That turned out to be true. She would never live in that house again, but there was a much different reason for it, as she was only moments away from learning. Chapter 3. Robert looked back down at Natasha for the last time before he rose. He seemed to have made his decision. "I have something that will make you feel better," he said. He walked away, leaving her sitting stunned on the floor while he stepped out the front door of the house. Tasha fought to regain her wind and her self-control. The fear was growing sharper inside her now. Whatever her father had to make her feel better, she didn't want any part of it. It was abundantly clear that she had made a mistake in remaining in the house while he was still in the backyard. She didn't want to repeat it by waiting around to see what was coming next. But her thoughts ricocheted around without producing any answers while she labored to force a plan. She couldn't go out the front without running into him. She could head for the back door, but the backyard was bordered by a steep hill and a wire fence blocking off an open field. Both routes at the side of the house would only lead from the back to the front, returning her to where he already was. The garage door opened only a few feet from the front door, leading her back to Robert once again. Of course, if she really turned up the volume on the situation, broke the lifelong family taboo about exposing their troubles to the neighbors, she could run screaming into the street and hope that some neighbor would get involved on her behalf before Robert could hunt her down and hurt her badly. But after years of living in this area, the male neighbors mostly avoided Robert Peernock, and the female neighbors rarely even came to the house if they saw Robert's car in the driveway. What if nobody stepped in to help? What if nobody happened to be around to do anything at all, not even call the police? Then he would have her. He would be very angry as he hauled her back into the house, alone. Her desperate attempts to form a plan never went any further. She heard a car door slam just outside the front entranceway, and before she could form the hope that he might drive off, she felt footsteps vibrate the floor behind her as Robert returned to the family room. Everything began happening quickly. Before she could turn around, she felt a burst of brute physical power seize her. It instantly took control. Her wrists were roughly grabbed from behind and held in back of her the way police will hold a suspect's arms. There was little muscle strength available for struggling in that position. Panic flooded her, gave her extra power to yank against the grip while she squirmed and fought as well as she could from her position on the floor. Though she did everything possible to battle the much bigger man standing over her, pinning her arms back, the conversation of wills was carried on without a single word. Nothing but gasping sounds came from both members of the father-daughter team. Their last dance together had turned to primal chaos. In seconds, Tasha felt steel bands snap tightly around her wrists, first one and quickly the other. She was able to twist around just far enough to get a glimpse of a pair of handcuffs. But in the next instant she felt her head forcibly twisted back to the front. She realized the handcuffs weren't the only things that her father had brought back inside to make her feel better. A flash of blue canvas flicked in front of her eyes, and she felt her father's hands on top of her head. Some sort of rough fabric was pulled over her face. His hands were forcing it down over her eyes, her mouth, all the way down to the base of her neck. Everything went dark. The hood had no eye holes, only one small hole for her nose and another for her mouth. As she continued to fight him, kicking out with her feet and the last defensive moves left to her, a little bit of light sometimes bled in as the air holes moved around just enough to tease her with a glimpse outside. But each glimpse lasted only for a flashing instant before the darkness returned. She tried to throw herself onto her side and rub the hood off her head by scraping her face on the carpet, but her father yanked her up into a seated position. She felt something like a hangman's noose dig into the base of her throat, searing the flesh. Any further resistance was impossible. But once she gave up her fight, the tightness around her neck loosened slightly. She felt his fingers fumbling behind her at the back of the hood and realized that what had felt like a noose was actually some kind of lacing tied at the base of the canvas, woven through the fabric like shoelaces. Even as the pressure eased and allowed her to breathe without choking, she could feel the tiny loops of the laces digging into the flesh at the base of her throat and at the sides of her neck. She had no choice but to remain still. If she moved her head very much, it pulled the hood tighter against her throat, cutting off her air. Now, as she found herself handcuffed and hooded and pinned to the floor, Tasha could clearly feel the bite of her fear. The long-standing protection that had always been afforded to her by the invisible insulation blanket around her feelings was of no use. With her skin, with her flesh, and with the marrow of her bones, she felt all too clearly the piercing cold terror blasting through her. And some part of her that didn't give a damn about handling the situation carefully just had to know whether or not she was watching her life in this world come to an end. She blurted out the words before she could stop herself. "Are you going to kill me?" "Yes." The answer landed like a blow from a blunt instrument. No more explanations about how Robert's life couldn't go on this way anymore. No more pleading for her to understand. Just, "Yes, Natasha, one of the things Daddy had brought you to help you feel better after being choked and dragged into this room and thrown on the floor is to assure you that your fears are correct. He is going to kill you." The hood's mouth hole wasn't much bigger than a dime, just large enough for the next surprise. She felt a rigid plastic tube press against her lips as it was jammed through the hood. Tasha started to cry out in reflex, but as soon as her lips parted, the stiff tube was shoved down into her mouth. She had to concentrate to fight back the gag reflex, fearing that if she vomited, she would surely choke to death right there on the floor of the family room. She didn't know how it was being held in place, but she couldn't spit the tube back out. Tasha wasn't able to form words anymore, even if she tried. The tube had focused all her efforts on breathing. The next sound seemed out of place, surprisingly harmless in the midst of this horror show. The squeaky pump of a spray bottle reminded her of cleaning windows in the summertime, or cleaning the glass doors leading out to the patio where her father had been when she failed to get out of the house on time. Cleaning the patio doors wasn't one of the chores Tasha was supposed to do that afternoon, but it didn't matter anymore. The other chores weren't going to get done either. She could hear it easily right in front of her. But it wasn't pumping window cleaner. Tasha tasted alcohol dribbling through the tube and into her mouth. She thought it must be some kind of hard liquor, but she didn't drink hard liquor and couldn't tell what kind it was. The taste was strong, harsh. She coughed and tried to spit it back out, gagging it back onto the fabric of the hood. "Swallow it, Natasha. This is the best way. Just swallow it." He pushed her down onto her back again and held the tube firmly in place as the harmless little pumping sound continued. Squirt, squirt, squirt. The alcohol ran down the tube and into her mouth, slowly enough for her to swallow, not so fast that it would run out and leave evidence on the carpet. "Just swallow it," he kept repeating, trying to persuade her that accepting the alcohol he was force-feeding her was the best way. He didn't specify if it was the best way for her or for him, but by openly assuring her that she was about to die, he was showing entirely new behavior from Tasha's past experience. She tried to think of anything at all that he might do to get himself out of the trouble he would be in if anyone ever learned what he had done here today, but she realized it would be impossible for him to explain it. In just these few minutes, things had already gone too far for explanations. She thought again of his matter-of-fact tone of voice when he'd answered her trembling question by confirming that, yes, he was going to kill her, all right. Try as she might, Natasha couldn't think of a single reason to disbelieve him. Not during the next 2 or 3 minutes while he continued to force the alcohol into her, and not when he decided to go to the next stage of his plan of activities to make her feel better and dragged her to her feet, forcing her to stumble blindly down the hallway. When she felt him turn her to the right, Tasha knew that they had entered her mother's bedroom, the one with the pleasant mess scattered around on the dresser, testimony to Claire as a working mother with little time for cleaning off a dresser no one else was supposed to see anyway. The photo of Natasha's beautiful smiling face sat in its elaborate wooden frame, reflected in the mirror next to the little ceramic Doberman puppy and the tiny man made of silver wire swinging forever back and forth on his balancing bar. Natasha imagined herself reflected in the mirror as he shoved her down into a seated position on the bed. Her cuffed hands braced her from tipping over backward. Her fingers could feel the familiar touch of her mother's bedspread. It was the only thing familiar to her in this haunted house nightmare of distorted sensations. Her father pumped a little more alcohol into the tube, but this time the pumping didn't last long. Robert Peernock was a list maker, an itemizer of objects and activities. At this point, he still had plenty of items yet to check off on his list of objects and activities designed to make Natasha feel better after being strangled. His hands left her body. Briefly, the hope ricocheted through her that he would leave the room, maybe leave the house. But the hope never had time to fully form. All he did was lean over and turn the radio on. An FM station was preset to play classical music the way Claire liked it. Robert left it tuned to that station. Now Tasha's encounter with her father in her mother's bedroom had some refined musical accompaniment. He got up, but he still didn't leave her. A moment later, Tasha heard her mother's closet door open. She tried to quell the panic, struggling to think clearly. What could her father be looking for inside her mother's closet? The answer came flashing back. Of course, the closet wasn't only her mother's. Though Robert had moved out years before, he still kept a large presence of himself in the house. His files, office records, tools, clothing, and personal objects were scattered everywhere, like voodoo tokens guarding the house from another man's intrusion. The bedroom may have been used only by Claire now, but as a wave of nausea twisted Natasha's insides, she remembered that Robert had things in the closet, too. He had guns in the closet, a shotgun, a revolver. He kept plenty of ammunition in the closet. And as he emerged, he didn't keep her guessing about what it was he had been rummaging around to find. She heard it right next to her ear. Click, click, snap. Click, click, snap. That would be the revolver, the black six-shooter with the wooden handle. Her father was holding the barrel of the gun at her head and pulling the double-action hammer back, rotating the bullet chamber, pulling the trigger. She didn't know if the gun had any bullets in it right now or not, but she knew there were bullets in the closet, plenty of them. Up to this point, Robert had been a man of few words, but now he apparently felt it was time to speak again. Natasha, click, click, snap, if you don't cooperate with me, click, click, snap, I'm going to, click, click, Blow your brains out. Snap. Tasha couldn't answer. The tube was still in her mouth. But she did the next best thing. She sat quietly and offered no resistance. Robert didn't like resistance. Things had been great between them when she was still a little girl and accepted his authority unquestioningly. She had always told her friends that he didn't begin to hate her until she developed into a willful young woman and started putting up resistance. And now her plan worked, in a way. He didn't begin beating her. He just went to the next item on whatever checklist he was working from and took steps to make sure she wouldn't be offering any resistance, whether she felt inclined to or not. He pushed her onto her side, knocking the tube out of her mouth. He pulled her feet up onto the mattress and quickly tied her feet together with rope. She couldn't see the rope, but she could feel the bristles against the skin of her ankles. And now it would seem that the next item on Robert's list was to hog-tie Natasha like an animal being prepared for slaughter. A moment later, she felt her father roll her over onto her stomach and yank her feet behind her, all the way up to her wrists. Then he tied the rope that was binding her ankles to the chain between the handcuffs. And still, Robert was at no loss for ideas. Tasha felt the stiff tube jammed through the mouth hole once more and again forced between her lips far back into her mouth. She heard the friendly little pumping sound, tasted the harsh liquor as it began to dribble into her mouth. By now she knew better than to try to spit the alcohol out. He was in no mood for resistance. "Swallow it, Natasha," Robert commanded, no doubt feeling sure that here at last was a teenager a parent could deal with. "Swallow it. It's the easiest way." She had to swallow some of it now, but still she tried subtly to let some of it leak out around the edges of the tube and onto the fabric of the hood. At first, Robert didn't notice. He was busy giving her further orders. "You need to cooperate, Natasha. It's very important." Click, click, snap. "You and your friends like to get high? Well, I'm going to get you drunk. In fact, I'm going to get you and your mother both drunk." Click, click, snap. "Then she's going to sign some papers. And if you're a good girl, Natasha, and if your mother does exactly like she's told, then I'm going to finally be able to get out of your life forever. You'd like that, wouldn't you? Hey, don't spit that out. Swallow it." Click, click. "Or I'll blow your brains out right now." Snap. Tasha began to swallow the alcohol. All of it. There was no more resistance left in her. Chapter 4. It was 6 p.m. on the day the crimes began when Tina Nussbaum left for the evening. She didn't know that Claire Peernock's daughter was already bound and gagged inside Claire's bedroom, but as Claire's boss at a property management firm in West Los Angeles, she knew that Claire was staying behind at the office to catch up on some late work. That was nothing unusual. Claire always tried to book as much overtime as she could. Tina had known that about her when she hired her as a secretary 5 months earlier. Since that time, Claire had often been the last to leave at night, but she never seemed to abuse the overtime privilege. Once the work was caught up for the day, she always locked up and went home. They had become friends of a sort, and over time Claire had gradually confided her marriage difficulties to Tina. Speaking in her soft voice and delicate French accent, Claire told how she had nearly gone through with the divorce before Christmas, but Robert had urged some kind of a 6-month cooling-off period for reasons of his own. The whole thing about a cooling-off period, or any kind of possible reconciliation, seemed odd to Tina, since Claire made no secret of the fact that Robert had been living with his girlfriend throughout that time, and that he kept his youngest daughter with him whenever she didn't have to stay at Claire's to attend her grade school across the street from the house. Claire seemed relieved that this coming weekend the girl was to return to her home and get ready for the new school term on Monday. Tina knew the deadline on the temporary hold, and Claire's divorce action was only 9 days away. Then Claire could begin to officially disentangle her life from a man she described as causing her so much fear and unhappiness. It was good to see Claire determined to get her house in order. Claire had an easy laugh and a playful sense of humor. She never showed any outward signs of depression over her situation. But Tina could guess at the amount of pain it would take to cause her friend to work so many long hours. The overtime was Claire's only way of creating a financial cushion thick enough to make sure that once her divorce began, she wouldn't have to fear being unable to provide for her children. So Tina left, feeling relieved to know Claire was finally about to get away from the clutches of a man who seemed to have caused her so much hurt and given her such reason to fear him. Of course, she had only heard Claire's side of the story. Tina was a fair-minded person. So as she walked out to her car, she reminded herself that there was no way of knowing for sure if Robert was really as dangerous as all that. Once Robert finally got Tasha to accept the alcohol as it flowed down the tube, he seemed to tire of the game. After another few sprays, she felt him walk away. Then everything got quiet. She didn't hear Robert close the bedroom door as he walked out, but it felt somehow as if he had. She lay helpless on the bed, hearing only the delicate music on her mother's bedside radio and the hammering of her own pulse in her ears. By that point, the amount of alcohol he had forced down her wasn't all that much, so she could still think fairly well, despite the liquor and the emotional shock of the attack. But as she began to try to weigh out the situation, it was clear to her that she was no longer physically able to help herself. The hood was tight around her neck, and she was still hog-tied. Even if she could somehow make it over to the bedroom window, there was no way to climb out and certainly no way to run. The room had a phone, but she couldn't move toward it without making noise. It would be impossible to dial. Even if she reached someone, he would surely hear her speak. Wouldn't he kill her instantly? She was going to have to hope for some kind of outside help. Tasha lay quietly while her thoughts screamed through her. She tried to guess how much time had gone by, knowing that it had probably been between 5:30 and 6 when the attack began. Perhaps another half hour had passed since then. Her mother could be home from work at any time after 6 o'clock, but she almost always worked overtime whenever she had the chance. That meant Claire could come walking into the house in a matter of minutes or a matter of hours. But even if she came home right away, Robert's idea about forcing them to get drunk and coerce Claire to sign some papers didn't make much sense. Claire didn't drink to any degree. If Robert actually thought he was going to get her to sit down and knock back a few stiff ones.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.